My name is Michael Ryan. I'm a bass guitarist from Central New Jersey, United States of America. Pretty average guy, but I like what I do. Playing bass. Months ago, I approached one of my best friends and fellow musician and mad scientist, Matthew Reardon, with some homework. That's one way to put it. I've always wanted an Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray, but all the time I've ever been a bass player, I've only ever owned or could afford one professional instrument, a Fender Precision Bass Special Deluxe. What I've always done, with the help of some brilliant advice by a friend of mine, Marcello, is I've gotten some cheap replicas, made sure that the wood was straight, and just found some better quality materials to do some small upgrades. It's worked for me for the most part. But this time, I knew that I really wanted to take what I could tell was a good template for an incredible instrument and bring it into the upper echelon. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Miss Bonnie Parker. Matt with two bass guitars. I had ordered two of the Ernie Ball Stingray replicas called the Sterling Subray 4, a red one and a blue one. The idea was that I'd be able to round out my arsenal as a musician with two really solid bass guitars, one being active, one being passive. The first of the two basses is the blue one, codenamed Kurt Wagner, because he reminds me of Nightcrawler from the X-Men. If you look at him in the light, he's got that blue. And I name all my shit. We quickly upgraded this one with just some better electronics, Delano MC4 L pickup, and a Mojo Tone Music Man preamp clone, two-band EQ. Pretty much kept it just in line like it was from the factory. And it's been my workhorse for the last 7 months. Things got a little trickier with the sister bass though. This one we wanted to do a passive conversion on. Became so much more than that. Now it's important to mention here that where we stopped with Kurt Wagner on the pickup and the electronics and the strings, those types of things were only at the very beginning for Bonnie Parker. Every single thing on this bass has been upgraded. Strings, pickup, circuitry, hardware, nut, truss rod, tuners, the decal on the headstock, the serial number, the finish. Oh, the finish. The bass is now passive, and it has more tone than anyone could have ever dreamed would come out of this bass. It would be very unfair for me to break this all down for you alone, so I'd like to introduce to you my friend, Matthew Reardon.
Oh, man. Chilling out with my man, Michael.
Yeah.
Today's the day after, what, 7 months?
7 months.
Hi, my name is Matt Reardon. I'm from the Jersey Shore, I guess you could say. Of course you could say. And I do a lot of different things. but one of the things that I've done was I've made this bass for Michael Ryan. I was given some wood to do it with, and that's what I did. I'm the creator of this bass guitar right here, which is the Ernie Ball Music Man Michael J. Ryan Signature Subpass 4. This is all about it. I'm about to tell you the entire story from top to bottom.
Is this a shot?
Oh, yeah.
All right, ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
I'm Michael Ryan.
I'm Matt Reardon. And this is Bonnie Parker.
That was bad. We gotta do that again.
All right.
I'm Michael Ryan.
I'm Matt Reardon. And this is Bonnie Parker.
Oh, yeah, that's how we have to do it.
And this is...
I'm Michael Ryan.
I'm Matt Reardon.
And this
is Bonnie Parker. That was good.
Let's just do it back and forth.
Yeah.
I'm Michael Ryan. I'm Matthew Reardon. And this is Bonnie Parker.
Yeah. All right.
I'm Michael Ryan.
I'm Matt Reardon.
And this
is Bonnie Parker. Awesome.
Nicely done. So let's break it down.
The way I understand it, and the way that I've always done this, was controlling the flow of electricity to get a certain sound that you want. So this guy, there's a difference between active and passive. Active is uses an external power source to power its tone, and its tone control. We wanted to do that like a regular guitar, like a volume, you have a treble and a bass, and that's exactly what he wanted. It seemed really simple to me. He had this single humbucker pickup, which is a huge pickup, got a lot of punch to it, and he wanted volume, treble, bass. And I was like, oh my god, I know how to do that. It's like, I do that to Strats all the time. We got the pickup, I wired it up for what I knew was right, and I had no signal. It didn't work at all. We took a look at it again, and then it was late at night, and we were like, alright, let's get back to this. I apologize to you over and over and over. Sorry, man. But I had no idea. That was the first day of having this, an 8-month-long, I guess, almost journey. But yeah, so Michael gets his bass. Second one he got, I figured it would be as easy to work on as the first one. And he got the bass and the pickup. And I tried to put it together, and it wasn't working. It wasn't firing up at all. Until I started diving into a little of modifications, that aftermarket modifications with the single humbucker. And there wasn't a lot of information out there because people keep their active systems in these bases. Anyway, without getting too technical, we definitely tried to make this volume treble bass, and it wasn't happening. Yeah, that's where the whole project started.
Let's talk about the circuit in particular, and more importantly, the man it came from.
Leo Fender, Fender Guitars. When he left Fender, he started G&L, and at night, after production hours, he would go upstairs and just draw up some wild stuff. That's where his ideas would come from. He'd just play. The L1000, I think it's called. The G&L L1000. And that's kind of what the circuit was, kind of down that vein.
That's so the pedigree.
The circuit has been lost in filing cabinets and napkins. And this is something that's talked about and was really not really a thing. Active electronics at the time were coming into their, you know, it was just really an exciting thing. And he wanted to prove that he didn't need a spot for a battery. You know, he didn't need that. He could find a way to get just as much dynamic treble and bass control as a powered one. So that's how the idea started. He wanted to have a lot of control with very, very, very little energy. What it really is, in the end, so he wanted this to be a volume control, treble control, and a bass control, which, for all intents and purposes, right now, it is. What it really is, to the core, is a volume control. The second is a bass cut. It's it adds treble when you roll up.
Yeah.
It's a treble. It control. Yeah, there's some treble control going on, but it's really cutting out all the lowest frequencies. Turning over on itself, it's folding in on itself, giving you all the high frequency. It's doing that with a 0.0022 mojo tone. Vitamin T, that's kind of a little, it's kind of been like hot rotted in the sense of the quality of the materials, and the layers of the materials were custom for this. So they were made to order by the good people of Mojo Tone.
This is absolutely shaping up to be some of my finest work. Look at, some of these are just, that was so hard to put on. Oh man, that's awesome.
So how about the pots?
Pots are important because they control all the current and flow of your electricity. It puts it where you want it to go. So when I chose the pots, I needed, from the jack to the volume, needed to be in a bandwidth that would handle everything the humbucker was giving it. So that now has believe it or not, that's a 250K A. It's pretty standard, but it's a little bit shallower. Then this goes to another 250 KA, but this one is a split shaft pull push pull, and really what that does is, as a player, what would you say the push pull function gives you? A little more grit on the pull. And,
I would say it gives me
drops a little mid out,
a bit more bark. Grit. Grit's a good word.
Yeah, grit is a good word.
Grit's a good word. The amount of range that's on that knob is wild.
It really is, though.
Yeah.
And it's a really even, really nice, clean sweep.
Let's talk about the pickup.
All right. What makes an electric instrument electric is there's a magnet that creates a field when plugged in. The field is intercepted, taken in, and put through amplification, and that's what you hear. The pickup that Michael bought for this was made by a company who's they put these together in their basically their garage. And you have a small boutique operation like that, especially pickups, you know they're doing the right thing. But this company that made the package that you got on your door when you ordered it knew what they were doing. But there's another company made something that was a little bit different, and it was a little bit more blanket of a pickup, a little inserted, a little like a I don't know the word, one size fits all. It sounded great, but what we did was we kind of did our own thing. We liked them both so much that made them have a baby.
This is the motherfucking one, but wiring needs to be like Seymour Duncan, and it's not. This is what's gonna work, and this is a lot. It's got higher output. Doesn't mean it's hotter. High output and hot are like kind of two different types of things, but like this is the one. You'll see. Can't wait.
To create a perfect pickup really does take a lot of focus and, yeah, and energy. And proto guitars, they really did really well. I hope they get bigger and bigger because they make good stuff. And so proto guys, I really hope you keep doing your thing.
It's a killer pickup,
dude.
Man.
Right?
I gotta tell you. It's got everything there that I need. It's a tameable signal, too. Just in terms of volume, it's part of the reason why I wanted a passive. And so to get, like, between the pickup and the circuitry, I just got the best of so many different worlds. Few people have also asked me about some of my musical influences as a bass player. There's two basses that stand out the most to me. One is Geddy Lee from Rush. And the other is Joe Dart from Wolfpack. Putting it out there. Joe Dart plays Ernie Ball Music Man basses, has a signature model of his own. Passive too, if I'm not mistaken. I have a feeling he would really like this bass. I'd probably lose my mind if he ever played it, so I'm just putting it out there. And while these guys are at the top of my list, Bonnie's already proven that she can sing a bunch of different types of songs.
Thank you.
Should we dive into hardware?
Sure.
Okay. And in particular, some of the work that you did to get those tuners to work.
Well, you know, you were talking about our friend Marcel, who was telling you that it's quality materials, and there's some tricks that you could use to upgrade instruments that are out of the box, let's say, that they're not given all the love that they could possibly get when they're given to you. The thing that makes a bass or any stringed instrument sound good is where the strings are touching, like a nut or a saddle. That is the point of where the sound is originating and terminating. It's going back and forth. So those two points are really important to sustain, clarity, you know, brightness, even overtones. These things are important to get what you want, all the dynamics that are possible. So those materials right there, that's a bone nut. When we say bone, it's typically a cowbone or something from that industry is a byproduct of that industry, and they're bleached and stored for a while. Bone is just a good, has a little natural lubricant in it, and it's really tough, and it holds up to years of string vibration. It can shatter other materials quite easily. And then at the bottom, I always make a lot of make saddles, and I do that to my own instruments. These were provided by the good people at Ernie Ball. This is standard equipment for Stingray model. That was one of the first things that we kind of recouped. This had I'm not going to say inferior. It still made a great sound. It was just lower than the standards of the.
It's like the economy line.
Yeah, the economy line of what this was. So yeah. so we got out of economy and went back into coach class A.
Yeah, or something, you know. What about the tuners?
The tuners, Goto, G-O-T-O-H. These things are rock solid. They're perfect. They're big and beefy. They don't overcompensate, and the plate is perfectly balanced. Distributes the tension well across the headstock, so I really like those a lot. They're practical, and they're really well made. And they look great, too. The chrome job on them is very beautiful. So, Goto. Yeah, they're the go-to. There was a little difference that you wanted me to mention that I had to compensate for. So for the lower line model, they had tuners that were they had to compensate for the great amount of tension that's on this neck. So they had to kind of spread it out. They used these tuners that were pretty big in the center. So the hole going through the headstock was pretty big compared to their American model. And I got the Goto tuners. And the Goto, since they're such a high-line professional tuner, they automatically assume that they're going to replace one of the original American tuners, but it's going into a lower line, which a lot of guys that are doing these upgrades will find some incompatibilities. That's the good thing about forums and talking to each other. That was great also. I kind of ran into that myself running some of these things.
What's going on is the ferrules for the tuners are too small. So the ferrules are actually, I took the Goto ones, the new ones are the small ones, and I bored out, this makes any sense, the old ferrule, so I fit the new ferrule into the old ferrule, and now it's too high, so I have to chop the flat part up, that little button off, and then what I'm going to do is reinforce it with copper, which end up looking like that. The copper is going to reinforce it. There's no like metal sounds with copper, so I'm just going to cut the shaft, and the inside and the outside diameter will be the same, and then we'll have these perfect so they line up with the Goto tuners. So yeah, man, it's little things like this, but it's fun. So this is exactly what I'm going for. So this is one that is put together, cut off to size, and then roughly filed. So that's that. This is the stage I want to get to, like almost a mirror finish. So we're getting there. Yeah, man. Details, bro. It's all about the details. It really is. And just to show you exactly what went down. All right, so here's the tuner. I'm going to clean that up really nice. Really great tuner. They just really just have a great feel to them. This is the 2-in-1 bushing or ferrule. It doesn't look like much, but that just that little bit means some it's just wow, because these look like this originally. I would have like this bushing would go into there, so I had still had the top and it looks stupid, plus the tuner peg was too low inside of it, if that makes any sense. So I had to literally, what I did was I cut that off, and it was all messed up and mangled, looked like that. And then I just, you know, worked on them really hard. Like I was trying to explain before, this middle part had to go inside of this, and it had to be like perfect. But you can see there's like a little edge there, and it's got tool marks on it. So those three have been cut to the size. They're just not 100% finished. I'm using the drumstick as the taper. What I do is I take this little taper like this, and I just pop it in the drill like that. Jeez, I'm not really good at taking videos. So
it's kind of like a mini lathe. And yeah, so this frying is polished, and it's going to be the last step. I'll take a picture of that.
So I'm trying to make everybody aware that the tuner swap is going to be a little difficult because I had to make a grommet. It takes up space that needs to be taken up to create a contact. Right here in the middle, these little round things, they don't look like much, but they're like 40 hours of work. Just a piece of steel that I roughly cut on a vise with a hacksaw. Not even an electric-powered saw. Yeah, 2 a.m. And broke it off, and I started polishing it and leveling it out, and I was having fun watching, Forensic Files. It's just always on when I'm working on guitars.
So, I guess we can talk about the bridge and the string for it.
So the difference really is, you want the sound of the instrument. You don't want the sound of a piece of metal that's holding the strings on. If you don't mind. The bridge that was given to us, it looks pretty much like kind of like the feel of what the Ernie Balls put on their best stuff. But it was doing two jobs. It was holding the strings, it was holding the saddles. Since I had put better saddles on, I saw that, you know, there was it was having a hard time maintaining itself doing both jobs. So I gave it a little break. So instead of just holding the strings and the saddles, it's holding my nice beefy Ernie Ball saddles. And I decided to do my own drilling and put the strings through the body. You can see there four little grommets that actually turned out, they signed up really nice. We'll talk about that in a little bit, but we're also sawed off pretty gnarly. But the strings load through the body of the bass, and you get the whole tone of this beautiful body here. It really, really resonates really well. You can feel it in your hands, and you can feel it when you hit those strings, it really rumbles. Yeah, the string through is a big improvement for tone. Kind of had full discretion on this, actually. That's the thing about this. Michael's a friend, not really like a client, and he gave me a lot of freedom to do what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
I guess the best way to say it is...
I gave him executive reign over this when I moved to Pennsylvania. It was evident that this was going to become a much bigger project.
Yeah.
And Matt's aspirations for it grew for himself, as they did to deliver an instrument that matched my vision as well. And,
yeah,
you know, so... We're getting closer to the end here, but we still got one big one to go as far as the breakdown's concerned, the finish.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the finish. The one thing with Bonnie when I first got her, the inspiration for the name was because I was initially reminded of like a femme fatale type of theme. You know, I'm big on naming my things. And so I was like, Bonnie Parker was quite a femme fatale. Before we move on, I figured I'd give a little bit of insight how Bonnie Parker got her name and the inspiration that was drawn from Bonnie Parker's story in real life that ultimately dictated the direction that this bass took, particularly in terms of its aesthetics. When Bonnie first arrived on my doorstep as a Subray 4, she was black and red. Black mat on the back that wrapped around to the front and left around the pick guard, sort of this red glow, which is this stain here, just finished in a satin, softer type of shine. And when I saw it, being the type of person that names his most valuable possessions, I was like, that kind of reminds me of like a femme fatale. And then I started thinking about like some badass women in American history, and I remembered Bonnie Parker's story. If you don't know, Bonnie Parker is one half of the Vagabond Robber duo, probably one of the most prolific in American history, and they went on a robbing and murder spree, ultimately ending in a police shootout where they got pretty f***ed up, but they went down in glory, I guess you could say. What struck me about Bonnie in particular was that the more I read about her, despite any of the craziness that ensued as a result of what they did, she was diehard loyal, and there wasn't much that she wouldn't do for Clyde. breaking him out of jail, and ultimately dying with him. And I figured, damn, that would be perfect. Bonnie Parker in real life was...
She was a bad girl. And she got shot more times than Big L.
Yeah. I also chose the name Bonnie Parker because of my mother, whose name is Bonnie. One of the ways that we've connected the most is through music. And my mother has had a major musical influence on me, especially as a bass player, introducing me to more sounds in the Motown era than I knew existed. And I wanted to immortalize our connection and how it's grown over the years. And what better way to do that than in something like a guitar, where if you take care of it, it'll probably outlive you. Matt, in his impervious attention to detail, had heard in passing things that I hoped I could do to the bass. If I ever built one, this was before Bonnie was even a thing. We were just talking about guitars and basses one day, and there were things that I had hoped, you know, I could put on to pay homage to my family. So in addition to kind of bringing an identity and the whole femme fatale vibe to life with Bonnie Parker's signature on the bridge, Matt also put a phrase that me and my cousins always say, sort of reminds me of my personal strength.
Shane, Ricky, right there at that bottom, that's for you guys. Haas.
It just makes my connection to this instrument so much more than just the instrument being what it is by itself. So when Matt refinished the bass, he had taken all the black gunk off the back that was choking the wood, left the wood grain, but the red stain on the front of the bass was really quite incredible. Polyurethane buffed and polished to a shine, it looks blood red, and the bleeding edge around the body of the bass ensured that it did not lose any of its femme fatale status. It looks so cool, especially looking down at the top horn. It looks like, you know, when you died in GoldenEye 64 and the blood would come down the screen. Bonnie Parker.
For about 7 months, I had this instrument, and he had not even, he gave it to me one day, and that was it. He hadn't seen it.
I hadn't seen it since May of last year.
So I'd give him updates and teasers. Oh, it looks so f***ing awesome. What I ended up doing was, I thought that the way that it was finished was doing the body a really big disservice. There's beautiful green wood under there. But as I was saying earlier, it had a matte finish, and it was covered by this black, not really pretty black, because it was flat, you know, weird flat in a way. And it wrapped, and there was a little, the red stain was there, but it was matte as well.
Yeah, it was too thick.
Yeah.
Like, from the outside, like, I like the color combination as it arrived, and I like the satin finish in a way, but in person, it just, if you really looked at it, it looked gunked on.
Another thing, I built that pickguard, took me 10 tries and I'm a little embarrassed almost to say that, whoever out there, oh, you can't cut plexiglass. No, can't, but I can now. I cut that 10 times. This is the 10th one. But anyway, there's a beautiful wood grain under that black pickguard. There's a beautiful wood grain. I mean, show them the beautiful wood grain. Here's the thing about the wood grain. I thought it was beautiful, but just as a testament to the Ernie Ball Music Man USA line quality control level of quality, this body was supposed to be a real Ernie Ball Music Man, and it was rejected because of a blemish in the wood. This is quality Ernie Ball Music Man material. They source some of the best wood in the entire country and the world. There's nothing wrong with this wood at all. It's insane, if you give it a chance.
Yeah.
I decided to gut the finish completely, and I was really nervous because I didn't say anything to him. He had no idea. Just like, this is going to ride or die here, Matt, and if I screw it up, I'll just go to an auto body guy and paint it yellow. what I did was I took the black off. I couldn't get the stain out. That was my plan, was to get the stain out and make it all natural. But, you know, we're glad that it didn't come out, because it turned out to be beautiful red stain.
The
way that it seemed like it was going to work out the best was to use polyurethane. Polyurethane is used in musical instrument manufacturing a lot, but it takes a long time to do. It takes coat after coat after coat, and then a drying process and a curing process. So you got to really treat it just right to work it right. So for it to work for you, you gotta play by its rules. Bonnie Parker's body received almost 100 coats, so 97 coats of polyurethane. A very special polyurethane that was made to order. So the polyurethane is a super hard coat, and when you let it cure for 2 weeks, so 97 coats cured for 2 weeks, got ultra hard, and it was glossy, extremely glossy. Unfortunately, I smoothed it all out, and then it became matte again. And I polished it to a point where it was going from matte to like a satin finish. And I was really happy with to get it from matte to satin, and it looked a lot better because the black was gone. I could see the natural wood, which I really liked. And even with the blemish and everything, it gave it a little bit of her own attitude, and I was really happy with it. I was really afraid to take that last two ending steps of really what this body needed to pop and really send it into just another dimension.
So I made my own spray booth, and believe it or not, this is Bonnie Parker. Now, a couple things about Bonnie Parker. Bonnie Parker was made, the body was supposed to be a real stingray. Came down the stain line. Now this is the stain. That's exactly how they did it, right? It's a deep stain, and they only did the top. And the reason they only did the top was their intentions were to obviously make it black to cover up that little grain there. That's raw grain. Then there was like blemishes like that. Like the guy who was staining it, his hands touched it, and it's, I sanded this so many times I can't get that off. So yeah, so the stain was put on, and then the black mat was applied from the back. They stained it first, they sprayed the back, and then they nitroed it. Nitro's like a hard cover. So this is, I sanded all of that off. Okay, I sanded the nitro off, everything. The stain, I sanded this, but the stain is really deep, so the stain wasn't gonna come out, and that wasn't my intention either. I didn't even want to do this. But I had to. So right now I am polyurethaning. So I took it down to the bare wood. Again, the stain, bare wood. Didn't want to take that off. And I'm polyurethaning it because polyurethane is better than the nitro. It's harder. It looks better. This was supposed to be a tobacco burst real stingray. But what, you know, the grain was f***ed up. So it failed. Went to the Sterling line.
It's a very sleek, smooth, flowing high gloss. And the way that we did that was we had it at that matte part, and we ended up going and sanding a little. I was afraid to take too much polyurethane off, but I had to remember it was 97 coats. So I was, yeah. And it's super hard. So I went through a step down process again, but even in finer increments, and I was starting to see that it was starting to look really good. I could see the depth in it a lot better. There was a lot more clarity, and then I had taken a suggestion on how to get the end result, and it was extremely simple. It's just a little bit of, not wax. Wax is not the thing. It's just a straight up polish that just needs to be consistent and even everywhere. If you can maintain consistency and evenness of how you're working it, you could quickly reveal just a beautiful, lush finish.
So let's talk about this base's official homologation into the Stingray family. What was needed, I guess, to authenticate it?
All right. Really, really the thing about Bonnie Parker that's so special, and why we're even doing videos about it, is so we were given something that wasn't really given any hope by the people who birthed it, really just kind of sent it out into the world. I wanted to turn that thing into a gem. So there was no stops, there was no limit. You know, not everybody who does upgrades to their guitars can do everything that they want and get everything that they want, every little part, but we were able to do that here. Every little nut, bolt, screw, every square little centimeter, or every millimeter of this instrument was carefully thought out, well planned for, and using the highest, finest materials that you can actually buy or make yourself.
Cool.
So basically, I wanted to make sure that this thing was just everything it possibly could be. I was in contact with the people, the Ernie Ball people, and the actual guys over there who are the keepers of their designs and quality of the products that they put out. And I was actually got to speak to them, and it was great. They were great people. They make such a perfect instrument. But in talking to them, it kind of became a thing. They got the gist that I wasn't just some kid trying to make his own bass sweet. Even though it was for my friend, I was really out there.
Yeah, that's me.
There was nothing going to stop me from making this for my friend here the most badass thing it could possibly be. So really, that's what I was after. I don't know why I set that goal for myself. I should have just made it easy. Said, here you go. But no, really, I wanted it to be the most badass motherfucker out there. I'm sorry. Right. I wanted it to be the most baddest it could be. and it is. It really is. It's rocking. I love this bass.
So what were some of the things needed to get it?
So I had to demonstrate that I was able to take something that wasn't finished completely by the factory to their highest standard and kind of do it on my own. And they helped me with that. And she's serial numbered now to out of the Sterling grouping that she was put into. And she's been recognized. She exceeds all the standards put forth by the company when they put out their best piece. That's cool to say, because I really, those guys, they put out a decent number of instruments. The attention and time and detail that they do put into their instruments makes them superior. Yeah, it exceeds the expectations put forth by the company, and that's great. And they wanted to just kind of congratulate me and say, hey, good job, buddy.
This is an official Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray.
Yeah, this isn't well within the parameters this had to play like an Ernie Ball Music Man. And it does. It really does. It's an Ernie Ball.
It
really
Ball
is
music
official.
Man. It
so
is.
Thank absolutely. You to those guys. I just want to say for real, though, Ernie Ball really does put out a great instrument. So in manufacturing, it's really, especially during COVID, it's really, you're taking a big risk all the time. And a lot of these companies that are out there are trying to make the best possible thing they can for players to grow and learn and get excited about music. This all really is about the love of the music. And business is business, of course, and things need to be done. But, you know, these people care about musicians.
Yeah. It was awesome to see that Ernie Ball could see the humanity in the whole thing. And it was evident in how much rope they gave him to pull this project forward and to really bring it into the Stingray family is huge. It's a crown jewel. I never thought that I'd own an instrument with an official Ernie Ball Music Man Stingray logo on the headstock.
I do want to thank a couple people that really, 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 they really gave me encouragement. Number one is the biggest thing to really do this project. I mean, you know, Eric and Jason over at Paul Reed Smith are just good friends and good people, good human beings from the gate who are passionate about what they do. And that's key here. The people that have the passion for what they do and do it day after day and make the absolute best that you can get on planet Earth. They have pride in their work and they're always down to help and take a second for somebody who's trying to do what they're doing. So those guys are great. Ernie Ball Music Man is just a fine company. They really know what they're doing over there, obviously, because they make some really just the best shit possible. But Mojo Tone, thanking them before. They're out in North Carolina and they are tone hounds. What they do with electricity and just material, they're nuts over there. They're just mad scientists. They're in just a room just thinking shit. Like, hey, you come to work, they're just thinking crazy shit about getting tone. And they're the best ones at it. G&L, G&L is, geez, pardon me if I don't, 67. But they have some very humble beginnings. Well, a master had put the company together. Two masters had put the company together. But that company is still putting out just fine ass shit, man. Seriously, go check out some G&L stuff. Like, goddamn, it's just the best.
Is there anything else you'd like to say?
No, I'm really proud. I mean, I don't call myself like, I'm not a guitar builder. I don't build guitars. That's not my what I do. I fix guitars. I know about guitars, their geometry, and I'm learning every day more and more and more. You never stop learning. I've learned a lot from this project, which I'm grateful for. I've met so many people that are the best at what they do, willing to help, and they're awesome people for that. We've got DR String, which really just pushed me luck. And really, hey, you know, we'll give you some, you're gonna mess up sometimes, so we have some strings for you, which they did. It was cool that people were behind you and rooting for you just to make something sound good and for your friend. So that's what it was. It wasn't started off really, hey, make this sound good for me, and then it was, yeah, I will. And I was a promise. between musicians is the important promise. We got it to where we wanted it. Bonnie Parker, yeah, she's a little badass. I hope just nobody shoots her up.
Yeah.
Really, really, my time with this was, I cherish the time that I spent with this instrument. And that sounds weird to people out there. I mean, yeah. It was time very well spent. And I have, my connection to it is probably...
It's as indelible as mine. Because you know what? Yours is, mine is yet to be. That's the thing.
You yeah,
know,
yeah. You really still have a lot to learn about her.
You know, it's been a lineage now. Manifestations and now what this thing can do. This is really the starting line.
I'm not saying if I did all this work. This is one of the best sound bass I've ever heard in my life. Thing rocks hardcore.
And it's she's pretty unique in her identity. There's no other bass like this.
I love it. I hope you love it. And you know what? I would just definitely do this again if you asked me to. This is about putting something. He'll have this forever. That makes me feel really good, and that makes Bonnie feel really good because she is worth it. You know, she wanted to play, and she's going to be played by somebody who cares. Rock on, man.
Yeah. You know, 2020 was a hard year for everyone. Speaking for myself, both in regards to and aside from the coronavirus, both individually and collectively, this was one of the hardest years for me yet. I'm a pretty inward guy anymore. A big part of what was hard about this year was just the sheer level of apathy that can drive somebody like further into isolation. When you witness that bleakness day in and day out, you lose faith in things and it happens to you faster than you know. And at some point last year, I just found myself losing interest in everything. And I just wanted to quit. I wanted to quit on this bass. I would call Matt twice a week and be like, you know what, man, f*** it, I'm done. Too much money, too much time, too much frustration. But he refused. He refused to relent. And it's worth mention, because when you're the type of person that can carry a value like that outside of your vocation and into your everyday life, you know that it's genuine and that it's worth real merit. Matt has been not just an invaluable resource in my musical world, but also a pillar of support in my personal one. There's literally nothing I've gone through over the last year of my life that he has not been there for, all while dealing with his own walk of life. What also makes him distinguished amongst even other people in his field is just his sheer level of perseverance. In his refusal to relent, he reminded me that you can't quit. And as we hit deadline after deadline, and it became more and more clear that this vision was going even beyond where I could see it, it required more time. And in this way, he taught me patience. The best things in life come from a place of love, caring, being there. When we cultivate these skills and we can put them forth in a way that highlights real human value, it takes whatever project we're working on and transcends its meaning. Bonnie Parker is so much more than just the femme fatale vibe, the blood red finish, the personalizations, the upgrades, and what she can do sonically. What makes Bonnie Parker so unique is the place that she came from. From inception to completion, friendship is what has carried it through, and friendship is what will carry it forward. Matt, there are no words that I could ever express well enough to convey my gratitude. So instead of tripping over my words, I'll just start getting really good at this bass. We have music to make, songs to write, work to do. Matt Reardon is an example of how we do that best work when we give. Thank you guys so much for watching. It means the world if you've made it this far. Please feel free to reach out to Matt or myself for any musical, creative, or technical ideas. And we'll see you in the woodshed.
My name's Matt Reardon. Her name's Bonnie Parker. Thanks for watching. Hit me up.
That's it.
Bonnie Parker.